When we discover an underwater archaeological site on the seafloor, we ask ourselves many questions.
Do we find a nameplate? If we find one of those, that makes our lives very, very easy. Unfortunately, we're not usually that lucky. So then it comes down to, what size is the ship? What shape is its hull? Is it made of wood? Is it made of iron? Or is it made of steel?
Where was it coming from? And where was it going? Was this a merchant vessel intent on trade? Or was this a military vessel?
And also, why did it sink? Why did it end up on the seabed?
The team use a portable magnetometer that can detect metal from nearly 1,500 feet away.
One technique of investigation that we often use on shipwrecks is we employ a magnetometer.
And a magnetometer basically beeps every time it comes in contact with something that's ferrous metal. So things like iron components, even coins.
Magnetometers were developed to be used underwater to find lost submarines. They are now a crucial tool in revealing the identity of countless shipwrecks.
And by understanding what large metal artifacts a ship carried, we can possibly date the wreck, and we can better understand the nature of the wreck.
So it's a really, really cool piece of kit.
And it's not long before their investigation finds crucial evidence.
This ship had a wooden hull.
It's got a paddle wheel and a boiler.
The archaeologists find elements of the propulsion system, including the rocker arm that helps power the paddle wheel.
These specific features reveal that this is a vessel from a narrow slice of maritime history, a side paddle steamer. Steamers transported mail and cargo across the Atlantic to the Caribbean from the 1840s until the 1870s.
All the original components were found, but that only tells us the type of ship. That doesn't tell us which ship.
Then the divers get a lucky break. Hidden in the sand, they uncover several pieces of cutlery, and they're stamped with a name, Zangranese Brothers and Company.
And slowly, the pieces of the story come together.
This is a really, really critical find, as it's a really key emblem of who it was owned by.
The Zangranese family operated side paddle steamers across the Atlantic from Europe and around the Caribbean, trading in commodities like sugar and natural fibers.
They were given literally carte blanche to do a lot of trade. Their reputation was relatively stellar.
Searching for more clues about the wreck, the team delved deeper into the history of the Zangranese family.
Once you begin looking into the commerce and the company, then the documents literally begin to come out of the woodwork.
Through detailed analysis, investigators were able to determine that this was the wreck of La Union.
La Union was one of two side-paddle steamers owned by the Zangranese family. It sank in 1861. But the team's investigation reveals much more about this merchant ship, which has been hidden for more than 150 years.
It's highly probable that the owners of this wreck did not want it to be found.
The Zangranese family had free rein on the high seas, their trade unchecked and inhumane.
La Union was stopped on one of its voyages just a year before it sank in 1860, and it had a slave labor cargo on board.
There were at least 30 slaves on this ship, including children. One was as young as 12 months old.
The documentation is clear. The Zangranese brothers were engaged in human trafficking.
La Union was a slave ship. But slavery had been illegal in Mexico since the 1820s, 32 years before the sinking of La Union. So what was a slave ship doing sailing from Mexico?
And we have evidence of shipwrecks which were part of the Atlantic slave trade. But this is a different kind of network. We're seeing something new.
Further investigation of historical records reveals something startling. The enslaved people aboard were Maya, indigenous Mexicans. This is the first Mayan slave ship ever discovered. So where was this human cargo being taken when slavery was illegal in their homeland? The answer may lie in Mexico's troubled past.
The War of the Castas was one that basically persisted from about 1847 till 1901.
This caste war pitted the wealthy European Mexicans, the Yucatecos, against the more modest and traditional Maya.
Those Maya in the northern Yucatan found themselves being dispossessed of their land. They were engaged in a rebellion. They were seen as enemy combatants.
Did this war provide the Yucatecos with a convenient excuse to banish their Maya enemy? Slavery might have been illegal in Mexico in the 1860s, but elsewhere in the Caribbean, it was still thriving.
Slavery isn't illegal in Cuba.
With their ship, La Union, the Sangrenese family could take advantage of the demand for slaves on the Cuban sugar plantations.
It was a marriage made in hell.
The suffering would have begun on board La Union.
The Maya were literally being placed in a cargo hold, and these were right next to the actual boiler. So they were literally put in harm's way every time they were loaded into these very tight and confined quarters.
The discovery of this wreck has, for the first time, revealed a missing chapter from Mexico's past. So why is this immoral trade omitted from the history books?
We really don't know very much at all about the Mayan slave trade.
The Yucatecos, who were in charge, would have wanted this minimized. So it remained a dirty secret and one that went to the bottom of the sea.
Archaeologists now know that people were trafficked on board La Union the year before it sank. But they still don't know exactly what happened to the ship on that fated last journey, until the team exploring the wreck uncover new critical pieces of evidence.
The firebox has been found in fragments, the chimney's been found in fragments, and there is large chunks of the wreck which have been exposed to intense heat.
The charred evidence on the sea floor matches records on land.
Just minutes after leaving port, the boiler dramatically explodes.
Records indicate that roughly half of the 80 crew and 60 passengers lost their lives in the explosion.
We have no idea what the real death toll was.
It was not customary for customs agents and Mexican officials to document this infernal trafficking in human lives.
The divers find no human remains. So does this mean this fated journey was without a slave cargo? The ocean may have hidden the true scale of this tragedy.
Once you enter the dimension of a very shallow settling of human remains, you're going to see an accelerated decomposition because you'll still have sunlight entering the fray, you'll have oxygen and other factors to contend with.
So there's still the possibility that trafficked Maya were on La Union when it sank. And it has since been revealed that up to 20,000 Maya were transported to Cuba on the ships of the Zangronese family.
The Maya have always been a proud and noble people. To be enslaved would have been the worst condition for them. This was not the Maya way.
The true scale of this industry of terror is yet to be fully uncovered.
We're only beginning to understand the extent to which indigenous people from Central America were enslaved.
But the secrets that La Union has revealed from its watery grave brings us one step closer to the truth.